red red nut on the forehead's push nut. Is that on tape? Did I just say that?
Hello, I'm Jack Rickard, and this is EVTV. I'm here with my compadre and consiglio or hail brain noto.
Hey, it's good to be here.
It's Cinco de Julio.
It is. Hail Caesar.
We've blown off fireworks and
they still have all our digits.
We're having actually a very cool July. It's been marvelous weather.
Think it'll last?
You know, this global warming may not be an equal opportunity employer.
Right, that's right, everywhere.
It might ruin your weather if you're in Southern California or Monaco, but here in the Midwest where we have crummy weather, it could be a godsend.
It could really be good, right.
The whole Southwest is on fire, and the Midwest, which is normally 105 degrees right now, we're having 75 degrees and afternoon showers.
Yeah, not bad. Pretty
like
good.
Spring, yes. It's very strange. And so the armadillos. Did you check the Intersphere for any sort of EV news?
I mean, there was little. It wasn't a very big news week this week. Let's see. Last weekend, we did have the Pikes Peak race. Was run last week. And we did have seven cars. We also had a motorcycle. The monster Tajima, he did win overall for electric vehicles, but that was fifth place. So keep moving on up. It's I think it's pretty close when we and the timing here. I mean, there's it's a minute and a half difference between the fastest guy on the track and the fifth place.
Well, that's kind of an interesting story in itself. What was Monster Tajima's time?
9:46.
9:46 is equivalent to his record before in a gas car.
Right, 2 years ago, yeah.
But here's what happened. We've got a new guy with a what was it?
He was a Peugeot. That's Sebastian Loeb. Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah, Monster Tajima is the guy who broke the 10-minute Pikes Peak run.
Right. Right.
What did this guy do?
He did 8 minutes and 13 seconds.
And 13?
Yes, 8:13.
I was thinking it was 8:31. Minutes and 13 seconds. He shaved almost 2 minutes off of this run.
I know. That's amazing.
That's a big deal.
He bombed it. It was crazy.
The electric motorcycle was
it
Lightning?
Took a ninth overall as a Lightning motorcycle, and that's a Carlin Dunn, that he's pretty good. He's a pretty good motorcycle rider, and he was pretty much coming at 10 flat. So
I heard from Michael Bream of EWE West they weren't at Pikes Peak.
Oh, all right.
They went to Laguna Seca instead.
Oh, they have that electric, the refuel?
Yeah, which isn't anything on the order of Pikes Peak, and he was so emotional about the Pikes Peak run last year. The whole thing sort of surprises me. He's talking about bringing his BMW E3 out to electric vehicle conversion convention.
Oh, cool. EVCon, that's here next
which
month.
Which is a month from tomorrow.
Right. Yes, it's coming up.
I suppose we need to get that book done. I ought to contact some speakers or something.
Jack's been slacking.
We actually have, he was saying he needed a covered carrier and was struggling to find one. High Performance Electric Vehicle Systems is up in Ontario?
Yes, they're in Ontario, right by the airport. Yes.
Ontario.
Yes.
And they're bringing two cars. I think Richard Rodriguez is bringing a car.
He's bringing his Porsche, I think, right? He's got a 914.
Well, he might be bringing something else. He was a little vague. And then we have a new gentleman, that more about him later.
Okay.
Jehu Garcia, who's going to bring a VW bus from Rancho Cucamonga.
Rancho Cucamonga, yes. They're in the foothills of Southern California.
Why don't you guys get together? And we rented a truck for Carlisle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we did.
It was surprisingly little compared to what you pay to ship a car. You rent the whole truck for,
And the guys. We had the guys for a couple days.
For a couple of days. For $3,000. And pool this together. You can save some pretty good
ducats. I think so, yeah.
And you don't have to ride along with them or anything. You rent the truck and the driver just goes and does what you tell him to.
Right.
I've got to believe they could save some ducats by forming a common cause.
Little cabal.
From Southern California, because we have a number of people coming. Yes. That's a long trek.
That is.
And so hopefully they can get together. What other news do you have?
Not much. Just everybody just keep an eye. You know, the Ohio State University is going to run an electric vehicle at Bonneville Salt Flats this year. They ran a hydrogen-powered vehicle a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. And they have set records. They've gone over 300 miles an hour in that car. And it's using the B456 batteries, used formerly...
A123.
Now
B456.
B456. Sure. Yeah, isn't that cunning? But keep your eye out. So I'm always watching for racing. That's kind of the next thing where there'll be some electric vehicles that may set some records again.
We've become such a Tesla TV, and I have a Tesla coming this month. I registered a domain.
Oh, you did?
Tesloids.com.
Tesloids Unite.
Yeah, maybe we'll start a line of stuff that's Tesla ads.
There you go. cup holders.
They had kind of a... now, this isn't anything. Some guy's trying to get some attention. It's called... I don't know what it's called. They do petitions.
Oh, it's on the White House's website. It's on whitehouse.gov.
Was it?
Yeah, that's where it is. Yes.
And I don't know what it means other than Obama might look at it if you have 100,000 signatures.
Right.
I don't know what that means.
Right, exactly.
they had a petition to let Tesla sell cars in all 50 states for Obama to do something about that.
That's right. Do something, darn it.
And they got, 108,000 signatures within the time period.
Yeah, and maybe even a few more. I think it closed today, maybe, the petition. So, yeah, at least 108,000.
Mm-hmm. Elon actually got on our blog to encourage everybody to go sign that.
Oh, there you go. All right. So, good job.
There you are.
Are you me?
I went and signed it, Elon.
Yeah, I did too.
We're good.
We're on board.
So that's probably enough news.
Again,
these are kind of boring. The numbers, they're selling more electric cars. That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Anna Kloppenburg, EVTV Amsterdam.
Yes.
Hey, Anna. He's like a fish out of water. Let's take a look.
Okay. Well, hey, everyone. Good afternoon. We've taken a road trip today over to Humming Performance in Balkbruch, the east of the country. We're leaving the boats behind, and we're talking cars this time. Humming Performance is a tuning car company that actually started importing Factory 5 kit cars a couple of years ago, and they are now the EU importer for Factory 5 kit cars. A new electric came over here today to talk about the new 818S project Factory 5 kit car that's coming out soon and will be imported here to Humming Performance as well. We're looking at doing a late fall, early winter build of the 818 kit car so that when all the boats come in and we can't play out in the water, that we'll have a car to show off our goods and wares this winter and be able to take this electric fun out onto the road. The 818 is called such because the 818 stands for 818 kilograms. It's a very lightweight kit car that was built around the performance parts of a Subaru WRX Impreza 2006 or earlier later models, I'm not 100% sure. Anyways, the Subaru platform is one that'll have a lot of parts available also here in the EU, and being built as such a lightweight car, we think it'll also be a prime candidate for making it electric. The forums seem to agree with us because there's a lot of hubbub already going around the electric vehicle world about this 818. Seb of Rebirth Auto and Evnetics fame is gearing up to make a adapter plate with hub connector for the warp or HPEVS motors to mate to the WRX transmission from Subaru. So that means we could probably develop pretty much a drop-in kit for anybody that would like to get one of these 818s and make it full electric. I think with the AC 35x2, it'll be an amazing match and probably a really bit of a supercar performance for kit car pricing. Hey, so come with us. We're going to go inside, talk to Freek Hummink, and check out some of the vehicles they've got here. And we think it's going to be a great time for building electric cars. We'll see you soon. Take it easy.
Blaasje als het ware. Flexbox Porsche.
Hope you enjoyed this week's update. We sure saw a lot here at Hummink Performance. We'll be back at the studio next week. And for now, you keep building. I'll keep building. See y'all soon.
That must
the
be
factory 5818.
That's pretty good. When the weather's too bad, the boat. Maybe a factory 5 build, huh?
Mm-hmm. I like the whole concept. We may do one too. I don't understand about these kit cars, Brian. Most of them, they list hundreds of them in some list that Kit Car Magazine used to do. 99% of them are outright fraud or scams or don't exist. Or
yeah,
the guy will sell you the mold
industry.
For it.
Yeah.
It's out of business. And then we have a few special editions where we get the speedster rollers usually,
mm-hmm.
and they've been doing it for 27 years, do you know, a couple hundred cars a year.
Mm-hmm.
And,
they do.
This Factory 5 just had their open house, and they had 150 of their builders in with cars, kind of like an Evcon, but
right.
with a lot more noise.
Yeah, right, a lot more noise than just of their cars. That's impressive.
So this guy is doing well with the kit car thing.
Mm-hmm.
Their new car coming, been coming for 2 years, probably coming for another year, is called the 818.
Yes.
And that was supposed to be its weight in kilograms. That's 1,600 pounds, which is kind of what we're shooting mm-hmm. for with Speedster-like. It had several other. He's trying to get younger people involved.
I think
so,
yeah.
A lot of custom car guys are 78 years old.
Yeah.
They only have a couple more builds left in them.
Look, a couple builds.
And so he's trying to appeal to a younger crowd.
Yeah.
And they called this the world car. And what they did was they tend not to provide a lot of running gear.
Yes.
And
right.
piece parts.
Right.
That come off of a donor car. Their GTM gets a lot of stuff from the Corvette. Mm-hmm. This one is going to get stuff from the Subaru WRX.
Right, right.
What is it, Impreza?
Yeah, I think the Impreza is where most of the running gear will come from, yeah.
And the interesting thing about that car is it's marketed worldwide, and there's parts available for it worldwide. It's been very successful mm-hmm. for Subaru. And so he's going to do an 818 kilogram car using fairly low cost and commonly available Subaru
right.
running gear parts. He'll give you the body and the frame, and you kind of bolt on all the other stuff from Impreza. Of course, he's got a trick transmission, I think.
What was it, a Mendiola? I don't remember. I think it was a Mendiola. They're trying to use a Porsche one first, and it didn't work out.
The trick is the kit's supposed to be 10 grand. Now we'll see if
we'll
he holds
see.
To that.
Yeah.
That's probably not going to happen. Where in theory you could put together one of these kits for $15,000 using Impreza parts.
Right. Yep. Yep.
So it's supposed to be aimed at a more youthful crowd, a world crowd, more exports for him. And in the Netherlands, Anna came in to the biggest representative in that area
right.
of Factory 5. Yep. And I don't know if he was thinking an interview or the guys didn't speak English or honest, just getting with the video thing. It's getting better. But that little car is very interesting for an electric car because it's light.
Yes.
And it's sporty and it's modern. And
that's and interesting.
It would be available. And Factory 5, their quality is very good. I've tried to talk to the guy. I think he's a complete a-hole. I don't really want to buy anything from him. He's a complete jerk. But they do a good product.
They do a nice,
and they've
nice
done well in the kit car business. And I think that'd be a good move is to basically do a kit for the 818.
That'd be pretty cool. I like it.
And we can probably knock that down where it'd be a pretty sporty kit. Well, AC35 dual.
That would be my thought right there. Yeah.
And some CAs and some What's happening with the Karman Ghia?
Well, I guess we should show them, but the watchword is rust.
Rust? Well, let's go watch some rust.
Let's go watch some rust.
Karman Ghia. What's going on, guys?
Well,
how's our running gear?
Well, rusty.
It's a little rusty.
It's a little rusty.
It's not as pretty as I once was.
It's rusty, but that's okay. It's a 73 Karman Ghia that's been God knows what pedigree.
Yeah. Well, this was a $9,000 Karman Ghia off of eBay that was supposed to be a show car.
Yeah.
And like a lot of these guys, they spent a lot of time on the interior. They get the paint all good.
They did.
And the stuff that will kill them, they don't even look at.
No, there's rust. Yes.
The back plate.
The backing plates, after Shane got the cap off, the grease seal off, it was just, they're a mess, the backing plates. We're going to have to cut the emergency brake cables off because you can't get the little holder, so I had to order new emergency brake cables. But not a big deal, you know, a $10
back plate,
part, $2
cylinders, part. The whole thing, let's keep the drum brakes.
Yep.
We've got some drums here. We can probably have those turned.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, these will turn fine.
Let's replace the rest of that. How about the front? Is it all brand new up there?
What did you do up there? Well, you did tie rod ends.
Tie rod ends.
We've got ball joints to be put in. We've got rebuild the calipers. We've got new disc pads. Return the rotors. What else up there? We get steering all the way up. We did the steering bushing.
I put in. We're going to have all new running gear up front, too.
Up front, too,
basically. Yep.
Cool. Sounds like a plan.
I think it'd be a good car when we're done. There's a whole bunch more. I don't know if they can see behind us, but there's a box over here, a pallet with a bunch of boxes. Yep. That's our motor controller, flywheel, pressure plate, and we've got some stuff coming out of order yesterday. Some brake lines. Hoses, all that kind of stuff too.
What kind of pressure plate are you putting in it?
The Kennedy, the Stage 3, the 2,600 pounds. Yep. So that is good for up to about 300 foot-pounds of torque.
Yep. And so you must have decided on an electric motor and controller?
I think we have,
I think we're going to do an AC 75 with the 144, I guess it'll be 146 batteries. It'll be, 150 some volts?
57,
it's getting to be a high-performance electric vehicle system year-round.
It is, ain't it?
I think it's a good choice for this car.
It is.
I think it'll throw it down the road like a bolt out of one of those aero guns.
Yeah.
There you go.
What do you call them? Crossbows?
Yeah.
And most of our batteries are going to fit right here in this, where there is.
Chips, huh?
In fact, all of them.
Good
all
idea.
Of them. We can put all 46 cells right where here. The rear seat
should
never
be.
Really was
never
anyway.
Really
anyway. It was someone's dream that there was ever a seat back there.
That'll leave you some room for some air conditioning and heat. And
yeah,
exactly.
Oh, most definitely.
Cool.
Yeah.
Now, does this have those heat ducts in the back like the thing did?
Yes, it does. Yeah.
Can you make him a heater like you did for me?
We could do that, a box heater with what we got in the store here. But I believe that unit that he bought or is coming is a heater also. It's liquid cool.
Yeah, that yeah. one from that what we're trying to cobble together right now, the mm-hmm. one from Vintage Air, is mm-hmm. has a heat exchanger for both AC and for hot water.
We may try and put a hot stat on it.
Put hot water heat?
That's what mm-hmm. I was, that's my mm-hmm. first thought.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my first step, is doing that.
And it works mm-hmm. for me. Vintage mm-hmm. Air, tell me about them.
They're a company that's been doing air conditioning systems really for custom cars and hot rods for a long time. They do mm-hmm. a whole bunch of parts. I mean, you can literally mix and match mm-hmm. Air conditioning heating system yeah. together with all they have, the controls, the ducting, mm-hmm. the heat, you know, the heat exchangers and everything. One thing that we will need to do is put our, is it the condenser? That has mm-hmm. these fans mm-hmm. and everything mm-hmm. on it. Volkswagen, when they did put factory air conditioning, which they did for a few years, including in 74s, Super and Beetles.
This one had it.
It was up underneath, was it?
Yeah.
yeah. Mm-hmm. It was up underneath sitting in the airflow. Yeah. There is a company that also makes that. God, he's just moved to Las Vegas. I've got to get his name. I talked to him on the mm-hmm. phone.
I had it green the other night.
Cut!
We may have been missing a trick. You see this grill mm-hmm. here mm-hmm. on the Speedster? It's somewhat more pronounced.
It is.
Our last Speedster, we put our heat exchanger under the car and lost a little bit of our clearance.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't we have it with like a pusher mm-hmm. that blew out?
Yeah.
And mount on the other side, underside of the deck lid.
You're exactly right. Yep.
We'd have hoses and wires that'd be moving when you opened it and closed it.
Right.
But, man, mm-hmm. talk about getting the airflow. It comes from underneath and kind of comes out through here anyway.
Mm-hmm.
If we had a fan to help it along, that'd even improve the airflow across the motor and controller.
Be able to pull it out of the motor compartment.
Yeah. You could stack a condenser and one of those Summit heat exchangers.
Right.
Put it right under there.
That's a thought.
Interesting thought. Mm-hmm. Yeah, might be able to do that.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like it.
We'll take a look at it. That's okay. How I'm going to do the Speedster Racer, the Speedster Light.
Okay.
Is put our cooler underneath the deck lid.
Mounted there.
And have it blow out. I may have to get a reversed fan.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it'll blow out instead mm-hmm. of sucking in, because that's the way these are designed. It curls up underneath and comes
out
this way.
Yeah, blows out.
Okay. But if I hung a heat exchanger underneath or had it blowing out, that would just improve it.
Yeah.
You might be able to get away with something like that with the air conditioner.
With the AC.
On the other hand, if it gets real hot, you might melt the whole. Well, this is steel.
This one's steel.
Might blister the paint.
Blister the paint a little bit. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, as I said, the air conditioning and heat are kind of important. Mm-hmm. I like that you've found somebody that does a professional mm-hmm. factory kit.
Yes.
And it sounds like it's going to cost me a bunch of money.
Oh, no.
Let's stay on top of this one. It's a cute little car. Mm-hmm. As I often happens on the eBay, I've got a pretty nice paint job, a pretty nice interior. And the underside of the car,
hell no,
is a lot of sense.
It just happens. But
we don't fool with it very much.
No.
We kind of rip off and put on new, and that's the that's the stuff that'll hurt you if you don't. And so we'll get new stuff under there, new running gear.
Mm-hmm.
It's not for VWs, fortunately, it's not very expensive.
It's not too bad.
It's kind of cheapest stuff we can put on the car.
It's really not that bad.
That's one of the advantages of these VW things is you get underneath here and some of the parts, they're just not very expensive.
No, and they're readily available too. We don't have to go searching for it.
Kind of get them overnight.
It's not that big of a deal.
All righty, good work. Let's stay on top of this one.
All right. All righty.
We're ready to go.
Yep.
Hoo-wee. it's okay. We'll clean it all up.
That's still the seam in the zone is eBay. These guys redo these cars and then get tired of them and put them up there for half or a third of what they've got into fixing them up.
Right.
And then you get them, then you get to fix them up.
Yeah, but that's right.
it gets you a little further down the road.
Yeah, and you know, well, at least that it'll stop and stay all in one piece.
Yep, it's throw okay. all new stuff under there, yeah. And it'll be cool. I think what they get away with a lot is bad engines and stuff, and we never care. We never even check if we just pull them out.
I know. That's the engine. What engine? What's that noise?
So we don't care about the engine.
No, that's probably where most people try to cream them, is the engine.
Staying with the VW theme, it's the 5th of July. EVCON's coming up. A lot of interest in the generalized electric vehicle control unit. Mm-hmm.
I can imagine.
And the VW thing. Let's do an update on that.
All right.
How's your light?
We continue to work on the VW thing, the 1974. You can tell the 74 from the 73 by what I call the hips.
Yeah, yeah.
This little thing here. We got in our CA60 cells, and Shane's got it mounted back here in the box. I'm just using this homemade rig that I made out of our little four-digit voltmeter and a contactor and a power supply and a little 0.1 ohm, 250 watt Vishay resistor.
Yep.
Cause it's, I've got it set where it cuts it off at 2.6 volts.
Is it?
And they're bouncing back right at 2.73 or 2.75.
I noticed that, yeah.
After they hit a couple of times.
Yeah.
So I just hook it up every time I walk by.
Right, right.
And walk away.
I know.
And come back in 30 minutes and it'll be 2.73.
Makes
and
it
I'll
simple.
Move it to the next one.
I know it.
And we've got so many of them to do,
mm-hmm.
but we're getting down where that's getting pretty close. When we get those bottom balanced, we're going to load up the ChargeStar software, and right. hopefully our Russo will come right up with that.
Come to life, ain't it?
And we can set our values in that software,
right.
and from then on it'll charge to that. Mm-hmm. We're getting ready to be the pilot, the test bed, for the generalized electric vehicle control unit. And what Shane and I did yesterday was wire that up.
Yeah.
This is, these use amp seal 23 connectors. And I put together the connectors and some split loom on the wires, and I had previously shown you all the wiring diagram. I'll put it up here again so you can see it. It's not that many wires to the DMOT. We've got a little place on our shelf where we can put our GEVCU, I think, back in there and get it mounted pretty well. And I'll be able to reach the USB port to load new software as necessary. Hopefully I can talk Colin and Ed into coming in when we get the wheels spinning to help me get this thing tuned up.
Fine.
So they can actually see what the software changes do.
Exactly.
Spinning wheels.
Right.
But that's made us a pretty neat. He ran the, we have a brake transducer and a one-wire accelerator in the front. He ran that to the back, and I tied into that into the generalized electric vehicle control unit.
Right.
And we may do a lot of things with that control unit in the future.
Yeah.
But the basic thing that you do with it is that it's going to be, it's gonna, when I say controller in an electric car,
right,
I mean the thing that translates primarily a throttle input into a go.
Go.
And if you take your foot off the throttle, it no go no more.
Right, right.
And so you can control that electric motor.
Yeah.
And we'll have a brake input for regenerative braking.
Regen.
But that's our primary mission of a controller. In this case, we're following more of the OEM model of splitting the control electronics and the power electronics, our DMOT 645 inverter. And we're going to kind of start following that model as well as we can on all our AC systems in the future, even like the Reinhardt will CAN bus.
I see.
And so we can move our control functions into software and hardware that we can
change it. Yep.
And have control of it, and hopefully then going to a new system, a Brusa or a Reinhardt, it would be a software change to incorporate their CAN bus commands.
Right.
I call the message digest.
But I see. Yeah.
The series of commands they respond to, which would be different.
Yeah.
But they'll accomplish the same thing. When you move all the control electronics into this box, this gets to be pretty simple.
Yeah, it does.
It's a torque command forward, a torque command back, you know, some things like that. But
with our control box, we can eventually control the economy on it, couldn't you?
Yes, we can control the economy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, like fuel economy or the mileage.
No, the U.S. economy.
We can well, that too. Well, we know that.
I mean, we'll have inputs and outputs that we'll be able to have daughter modes and run fuel gauges.
Right.
And, get data from other CAN bus devices about our battery or our air conditioner or whatever.
I see.
But those will be add-ons. The heart of the vehicle control unit is to take a throttle input and turn it into a rotating shaft out of that electric motor. And so that's what we're working on. I have said on numerous occasions that I've never met a connector I like. Nothing's changed.
Nothing changed.
We inherited the Amp Seal 23 from the DMOC 645.
Yeah, right.
We use a very similar connector on the Brusa. Reinhardt Motion Systems uses the, essentially the same one.
I see.
In a 35 pin. The future generalized electric vehicle control unit, we're going to have open source software, but the hardware is already getting pretty icky.
It is. It is.
And for us to be able to assemble it, it's going to have to get ickier more.
I'm afraid.
We're going to actually incorporate the Amp Seal connector in a shield.
Right.
For the Arduino.
Okay.
So we cut down all the wiring we have to do.
Right.
But the Amp Seal is, and I don't like the connectivity.
Yeah.
This crimper is near enough $500.
Makes your life easier, don't.
But it, you almost have to have it to crimp pins for this. But high performance electric vehicle system uses it. Now they provide you a pretty much completed connector, but they leave off the brake input, and they've got a clutch. They've got some optional things that aren't really wired up. Yeah. Reinhardt Motion Systems uses the same connector. Yeah. Brusa uses the same connector.
They do.
DMOC 645 uses the same connector.
How about the Curtis?
The Curtis uses the same connector.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
They're all the different pin numbers of the same Amp Seal connector. Now, why do they do that? Well, here's the connector. On the back side, it's got a rubber grommet that you push the pins through.
Right.
And it comes up into this. It's all crimped, no solder.
Yeah.
And so the whole thing flexes, and it's essentially watertight.
It is, ain't it?
And the pins that go on your plug are actually female.
Yeah, right.
And the pins on your connector, or what you would call the header on the device, are male.
Yeah, I see.
And this is the automotive plug that everybody's using. I didn't get to vote. Not a single one of these people called me and said, Jack, what connector would you like to use?
Yeah.
Which my main experience is mill standard connectors.
Oh, yeah.
Circular connectors to a mill spec. But they're quite expensive.
They are, ain't they?
And I don't like them either.
No, I know it. I know it.
So this is about as good, and it just gives me something else not to like.
Yeah, right.
When you get these, this little red thing is extended. You push in your pins and then snap this down.
Oh, yeah, I see.
And we put a, they call it a wire relief. It's a couple of identical pieces of plastic that go around the back
side
to shield it.
I see.
But the way you do this, or the way I do it, is take a pair of needle nose pliers and the pin, and they're always spread just a little too far.
Huh.
And so they don't really fit in the die right. So I smash them in just a little bit, mm-hmm. so this will work. And you take your die, it actually has two separate pieces on the die. One is for the small wire crimp area, and the other is for this band around the back that actually goes yeah. around the insulation.
I see. Yeah.
And all this is smaller mm-hmm. than I can hardly see.
No.
And so what I do, this is an 18 or 20 gauge size. This mm-hmm. die will do 16 or 18, 20. And this crimper is actually set up to where it ratchets. It won't yeah. release now.
Right.
And I'm just starting to move it down, and it's just starting to curl that outside.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's held kind of firmly in position.
Right.
And that's important because mm-hmm. I'm going to take a wire that's stripped mm-hmm. over a quarter of an inch, I'd say nearly mm-hmm. 3/8, and stick it in there. Mm-hmm. And I should get just a little bit of insulation in there.
Right.
And then I come on down with it.
Master down there.
And that gives you a good crimp on the wire.
Oh, yeah.
That mm-hmm. goes around the insulation, mm-hmm. and we have a perfect yeah. Mm-hmm. crimp on the thing. Can yeah. you do this with the needle nose pliers? Some guys yeah. can, and some guys can't. Yeah. I'm a guy who does, but I can't.
Yeah, yeah. yeah.
And when I do that, I wind up with pins that do not seat very well.
Oh, I see, yeah.
And now yeah, I've got yeah. a connector that isn't really mating very well. Mm-hmm. You take your pin and stick it down through the weather seal into the right. hole, and at some point it catches the fins on that pin
I see.
On the mm-hmm. plastic guard in there,
mm-hmm.
and I tug on it a pretty good lick,
yep.
and it doesn't come loose. Now I'm in there. Once the pin's in, you snap this okay. down, mm-hmm. and you can look in there and see your pin
right.
and where it is. Mm-hmm. And it'll be held, that locks it in position
right.
where it can't go anywhere. And so that's a pretty good lock, mm-hmm. and it makes a pretty good connector. Then you put your wire relief or your wire shroud
right.
around here, mm-hmm. a little 440 screw on each side, and that gives you a plug that is pretty sturdy, is quite weather tight.
Weather tight, yep.
And assembles probably about as well as any of them
yeah.
if you have the crimper.
Yeah.
And it's a very expensive
crimper.
Yeah,
I know it is. I know it is.
So without it, you're left using a needle nose plier
mm-hmm.
trying to crimp it
yeah.
where it's kind of round and nothing sticking out. Because
right.
then you won't be able right. to insert it correctly
yep.
if it is. And so if you want to do a professional job, you have to have the crimper.
The
but if you're careful, mm-hmm. I've done a lot of them with needle mm-hmm. nose, but I've had problems with some of them because of that. And so, but this is essentially the automotive connector for electronics.
Yeah.
Bruce mm-hmm. picked it, Curtis picked it.
Yeah.
Reinhardt Motion Systems picked it, Nazar Dynamic picked it. Jack never did pick it. But this is what we get to wear, and we're going to continue with that with the GEVCU. If I had a connector I liked, we would use that.
Right, right, right.
I don't like any of them.
Yeah, I don't like any of them, does.
It's just a place to have a problem.
It is.
I spent an awful lot of time fixing F4 aircraft, and it was always the connectors. Or any place the pilot's hand could go.
Oh, really?
That was also a bad place.
Yeah.
Switch.
Wow. No.
Switch or a button.
Yeah.
But I've had a lot of problems even with mill standard connectors.
Right.
And so, but that is your amp seal 23. We're probably going to go to the 35 on the GEVCU.
Yeah.
Just so we have plenty of pins for expansion.
Mm-hmm.
And this then snaps on, and once it snaps on, you can't get it off.
Right. It's,
and it's usually on the bottom side in the back, and you have to reach in with a little screwdriver and flip this up. I think you're supposed to be able to press on it, but that never does work. you put a screwdriver in here and pick it up and pull it out.
And not by the wires.
That's exactly how you're supposed to do that. You know, you put a screwdriver blade in here, pry it up, that releases this catch.
Oh, I see,
And then it slides out. But I always have to get chained to unplug it for me because my fingers won't do that. So that's the amp seal 23, and we have our DMOC and our GEVCU, or GEVCU.
Yep.
And hopefully we'll have Ed Clawson and Colin Kidder at EVCON.
Right.
I'd like to get them down the week before to play with this thing. And then that's kind of what's between us and the thing rolling.
Rolling.
Yes, we got to finish our balance, get the charger working on it. We've kind of painted ourselves in a hole on 12-volt with that contactor.
We
did. But I think we've got some ways around that.
Okay.
That we might be able to work out.
Okie doke.
We may have to jump start it.
Yeah, every time, ain't it?
No, once it's on, it'll be on until you hit the emergency switch. And then you'd have to jump start it again. Maybe this one will have a 12-volt battery. Yeah. I don't know. But I like how this is looking back here. And we're trying to keep the wiring neat. Now, that's this is how you would do it to make it fairly neat. We always start out that way.
Yeah.
We'll have five different generalized electric vehicle control units on here before it's over.
Yeah.
A couple of the controllers, different throttles. Because we kind of are free about changing things because we can improve them and we can tell you about a new component that does better than the one we picked. The first round. So you kind of learn with us, and that's why I can't hardly open the hood on the Cadillac Escalades. The wires escape, and I can't get them back under the hood.
And half of them don't go to nothing.
And half of them don't go to anything.
No, I don't.
And I've got the same problem on the Mini Cooper, but it's several versions
later
along. We start out looking nice, and then we keep changing it until it doesn't any longer. That's the VW thing update. I think we're getting pretty close with GEVCU.
I can't wait to see it roll.
And I believe it'll roll pretty sprightly.
I do too.
Jeff Southern's bringing his with a little AC50 in
it. Is it a 50? Is it? Yeah.
I'm hoping to kick his ass.
I know it. I know it.
On the drag strip.
Yeah, we're going to.
He's bringing it to EVCON.
Yeah.
In fact, he sent us a little video walk around of his finished thing. Let's have a look.
All right.
Hello, Jeff Southern here from Kennesaw, Georgia. Today is July the 4th. I am celebrating my Independence Day with driving my electric thing around. Thought I'd give you guys an update on the progress I've made on the car. It's been about a year. I have worked on the car probably the better part of a year. Mostly on the weekends, typically 1 to 2 days a weekend, maybe 4 to 5 hours a day. I estimate that I have about 200 hours probably in the total restoration and conversion of the vehicle to electric drive. Vehicle is running great, thoroughly enjoying driving it around. Recently went to a car show in downtown Acworth where I met Dennis Carter, who is also an EVTV viewer. Enjoyed talking to him and listening to some of his information about electric bicycles he's working on. I think Dennis is definitely ready to tackle the full-size automobile recently. Going to hopefully give him any help he needs in making that happen. I'm going to give you an update on the thing. I'd hope to have some driving video. But, of course, I took this week off of work to finish up some small details on the car. And as luck would have it, it has been raining solid for the last 3 days. I mean, it's really raining. We have flash flood warnings out through most of the state. This is probably the wettest summer in the last 20 years. Normally, we're actually experiencing a drought this time of year, but right now it's full-blown rain. Just going to give you an update of the car. The car is running extremely well. Probably got about 230 watts per mile, somewhere in that range, maybe 220. Car weighs about 2,200 pounds, so it seems to fall right in line with Jack's 10 pound, a watt for every 10 pounds worth of car. seems to be actually quite accurate. Well, anyway, I hope you enjoy the update.
Thought I'd give everybody a walk around of the car. Car's mostly finished now. As you can see, I got the running boards on it. I got the convertible top on it. I've got my rear seats installed, painted, reupholstered on the rear. Got my windshield wipers working. Had to replace the windshield wiper motor. It was burnt out on it. Using the standard old 40-year-old wipers. May replace those with something a little more modern. Thought I'd give you a look inside the car. This is a view inside the car. It's a nice rainy day this 4th of July, so I happen to use a light so you can see everything. What I've done with the car is I've mounted my 4-inch display in the dash, as many of you have seen. I also installed a power-up button. To energize the car, you push the button, and you'll see a blue LED start to blink. What that's indicating is that the car is powered up and the key switch is not on. So this blinks to indicate to tell me that it's in a 5-minute countdown, so it's going to shut off the power to the car. As you can see, the touch screen is powering up and should come up in a few minutes. Thought I'd let you see what the display in the car looks like. This is the main screen here, and I'm going to push the reset button. And as you see, if you hold it down long enough, it'll reset the pack to the maximum hours. The variable in blue is the pack voltage. That is accurate to at least a hundredth of a volt. And then the amps, like right now with it powered up, running the 12 volt adapter and a few accessories, it's pulling a little over a quarter amp from the pack. I'm going to turn the key switch on. And I do currently have the main power is off, so I'm going to turn that on. And if you can hear that buzzing noise, that's my contactor in the back of the car back here buzzing away. Thought I'd let you hear this good. That's my 24 volt contactor. I'm going to put a 28 volt contactor in there and see if it'll help with this. So as you can see, I can switch to reverse or forward with this switch. I can also stop and start the fan on the heat sink. So, fan on the heat sink turns off, fan on the heat sink starts. There is a trend graph in the car. It'll trend amp draw. The red is the amp draw and the blue is the pack voltage, so you can see how much it sags. I also have a configuration screen. This allows you to set calibration features like the maximum shunt, minimum shunt, the daughter level mode, and the pack capacity, which I've currently got set to 180 amp hours. My shunt turned out to be just a hair off, so those are the correct calibrations. That's calibrated with a brand new Fluke meter. I'd say they're accurate easily to a hundredth of an amp now. So that's how the system works. That's so basically, the touchscreen in the car keeps track, very accurate track of the amp hours. For example, I'm going to turn the headlights on, and you'll see the amperage go up when I flip the brights on. Go up a little more. So it's a very accurate representation of the pack voltage. That's kind of it for what I've programmed so far. I'm going to make it a lot prettier as time goes by. One thing I've done in the car is installed a amplifier. This is just an MP3 input. I don't have it prettied up yet. I'm going to mount a plate down there to cover everything up. But it does have a remote volume control, so I can turn the volume up or down. I'm going to make a plate to go up under the dash here in this area. So the only thing it's going to have, it's going to have a 12-volt adapter for this Bluetooth adapter and a power on-off switch for the unit. And that's it. Everything's going to be done with Bluetooth. Found a really nice Bluetooth mount. This was for the phone. It expands out, squeeze it together, and it locks the phone in place very good. It happens to actually be for a motorcycle. It has a motorcycle clamp. Works really good for this grab bar in the front of the car here. For those of you that aren't familiar with the thing, this over here is the hood release. Of course, that's my power on off button. The little map light. I thought was interesting, the The cover is actually also the switch for this little light. Thought that was kind of interesting. As you can see, this little blue LED button is solid on. That means the car is up, powered on, the switch is on. I'm going to turn the switch off. Here's the main contactor drop out, and then the LED ring starts to blink. That indicates that I've basically got 5 minutes before the car is going to power itself down. It'll power the display down, which uses a good bit of current. But if I plug the J1772 charger in, or any charger for that matter, it'll immediately realize that it's charging and go back to being solid. So that's how I've decided to make it work. I'll explain it a little more up under the hood here. For those of you who haven't seen the layout under the hood, I apologize. Some of the wiring is going to have to be cleaned up, but I've just got everything wired the way I want it. This is the PLC that I'm using in my car that controls all the functionality of the car. So this is the main processor. This is an 8-channel universal analog input card. And this is a relay card. It has 8 additional relays. The unit itself has 2 relays across the bottom, and it has 4 high-speed outputs. Across the top, I have a total of 10 inputs. 4 of them are high-speed inputs, and they're actually used for 24-volt inputs. And the other 6 are for just general-purpose 12-volt inputs. For example, the key switch is wired to one of the 12-volt inputs. 24-volt inputs, I'm actually wired over here to my J1772 card. Again, I'll show you that in a second. A couple of things of note. A lot of you knew that I was having trouble with the reading the shunt voltage correctly. This is a shunt isolation transformer. What it does, it takes the 0 to 50 millivolts from my 800 amp shunt, and it converts it into plus or minus 10 volts that run over here and the analog card can read. This also offers 3,000 volt electrical isolation between the pack and your control system. As many of you know, my car winds up having to have 2 buses on it. So this is a 24 volt DC to DC power supply. This happens to be an Allen Bradley one that we sell. It can provide up to 50 watts of power, which is more than enough for the PLC operation. I think the PLC operation totals about 50 millivolts off the main pack, something of that range. That powers the PLC, the I.O. cards, and this shunt isolator. In addition, I also have a pack voltage isolator. This device actually takes the pack voltage and converts it into 0 to 10 volts. So instead of 0 to 150 volts, it's 0 to 10 volts. Again, that goes back into the analog input card here so I can accurately measure the pack voltage. I've checked it with my meter, and it's accurate to 1/100 of a volt. One thing I do a little different is because I do have 2 different DC to DC converters. This is my Meanwell 12 volt. I believe this is a 450 watt. I use a relay, 24 volt relay, to switch the pack voltage onto the 12 volt, so I can actually power down the 12 volt bus independently of the 24. That just reduces power when it's sitting idle. I've checked everything, and my power is down to, I think it's 52 millivolts when it's just idle. The car's charged and off. Again, as I said, I mounted my J1772 connector here. That is actually wired into the PLC, so I'll know when the pack is connected. The Elcon charger has a wire that allows you to start and stop the charging. So I've got that wired into a relay output on the PLC so that when I get to a certain voltage, I just shut the charger off. That constant voltage stage lasts about 5 minutes. It wreaks all kind of havoc with the battery. You're talking about less than a mile's worth of range. I think it's absolutely silly that anybody even bothers with the constant voltage stage of the charging. So that's kind of what I have under the hood here. You have the most negative bus rail, the most positive bus rail, a couple of fuses for my DC to DC converters, a little fuse hiding up under there for the J1772. This is one of my front battery boxes. This is contains 6 cells. I like Jack's little battery booties, but found this works pretty good too. This is just some exercise mat. You basically put this under your exercise machines to keep from scuffing up your floor. It cuts easy. It is completely non-conductive. And works very well. Actually, you heard the power cut off, it timed out on the 5 minutes. So now the only thing powered up is the PLC and the 24 volt power supply. So the 12 volt power supply powered itself down. I like these things. This way, if the car ever flips up or bounces up, the batteries can't touch the aluminum battery box they're made of. It just keeps people's fingers out of it. Also, if you'll see the holes here, I've got some PIMs in here. So there'll be a solid lid here. Of course, I have the 10 cells up under this one, which go down in a little hole. So that's kind of how it's laid out under the hood. Just thought I'd give you a quick overview of that. Walk around here back, and you can take a look at the rear of the car. One thing I've done recently is I have put all LED lighting in. So all of the lights around the car are LED. I believe you can actually see the little LEDs through the clear lens of this one. So you can see the little LED bulbs. All I did is just replace the bulbs that were in the car. Of course, the all-important EVTHING tag. And this is what it looks like in the rear of the car here. You see I got the two battery boxes. Again, this battery box is covered with this exercise underlayment material. Exercise machine underlayment material. My Curtis controller, wired directly to the AC50. This is the offending contactor. I did put a little black piece of rubber between the contactor and the firewall, and that really helped the noise level a little bit. This is my 12 volt fuse for the back of the car. The red wire brings in 12 volts from the DC to DC converter, and the black wire brings in the switched voltage. That is the correct color coding in the Volkswagen. This is a 100 amp fuse. If you'll see the smaller cable here, this is the most positive part of the car, or the battery pack. It's actually this terminal up under here, and this cable simply is routed over and into the box. So it's a good place for me to pick up 24. I did put a ferrite core around here. I found this actually cuts down on a good bit of electrical noise coming from the Curtis controller. So these little ferrite cores there, little clamp-ons, might be fairly handy for people to have. This is just a little two-gauge cable. It'll handle up to 100 amps, so you know if I ever get a charger that can handle more than 25 or 30 amps, I'll worry about it. This just goes up to the front of the car and again gives me the plus pack voltage up at the front of the car. Hiding under here is the fuse for the Curtis controller from the pack voltage. This is the little relay that comes with the kit. So you take your 12 volt switched voltage, which comes from there, goes through the relay, and then this provides 120 volts to the wiring nest over here. That is the main fuse for the power pack. This connects the front to the rear power packs. As you can see, that goes up to the front of the car. Still find it odd that you wind up using a 400 amp fuse for a 650 amp circuit, but if you run the numbers and look at the graph, that is actually what it comes out to. Have a little grease under here. One of the universal joints got a little bit loose, and one of the bolts backed off a little bit, and a little grease came out. Not enough to hurt anything. Just thought I'd let you see what the back of the car looks like. One thing I did put on the front of the car is a tow bar hitch. This is welded to the bumper. There's a piece of steel that's under here that connects back to the torsion tubes. So you're actually not pulling on the bumper, you're pulling on the torsion tubes. Thought having a tow bar where I can hook it up to my truck for towing around here might be pretty handy. Don't know if I would drive it all the way up to Missouri from Atlanta, Georgia with a tow hitch, but I guess I'll find out how well it works first, but I'll most likely put the car on a trailer. Just thought you might be interested in seeing that.
Well, that's it, guys. I just thought I'd give you a quick update on the car. I really wish the weather were better, so I could give you some video of actually driving the car. I can't tell you how much fun it is to drive. Everywhere I go, people swarm around this car. The car itself gets attention, and then when people find out it's converted to electric drive, usually you answer a few hundred questions on the spot. Think it's actually probably the only car I've ever owned that women seem to like. I've owned high-performance sports cars and everything, but women actually like this car. My cousin told me that she thinks that it's because women think it's a Barbie car, but I actually love driving it. If you're thinking about doing a build, I really think you should. I think you will enjoy it more than most of the manufacturer's cars, with maybe the exception of the Tesla Model S. I mean, that car is just probably one of the best cars ever made, period. So hope to see everybody at EVCon. Looking forward to it. We're about a month away, so hope to see everybody there. So long from Kennesaw, Georgia.
Well, looks like you and Shane have been busy.
We have, but not busy enough. No. Jeff Southern's way out in front of us.
Oh, he is.
He's driving the car, loves it.
Oh, man.
His wife loves it. And so he was going to build her a 65 Mustang, which I think would have been very cool. But she took a test drive in a Tesla Model S and pointed out to him six times that their anniversary is coming up in September. And so I think we...
There went that idea. Huh?
I think there went that idea.
That's
and
funny.
So
good for her.
Happy anniversary.
Yes, exactly.
Juanita or whoever.
That's funny.
But his thing looks great. Of course, he's done some very advanced things with the PLC industrial controller, basically.
Yes.
And and he's going to be up here at EVCon with his thing.
Yes.
Which I think he can probably tow up here. A trick that we learned with Lee Moorhead and the Swallow, Jeff, take it out of gear.
Yeah, please make sure it's in neutral.
Put it in neutral.
That's right.
And
bad things happen if it's not.
Yeah. But yeah, I think it'll trailer up here just fine if you put it in neutral. The motor's not turning, and the transmission isn't either. Really.
Not really. No.
Just the axles, and it's a splash transmission anyway.
Yeah. It is. Yeah, it'll be fine.
It would be fine for you to tow it behind your truck. And so I can't wait to see it in person.
Oh, yeah, it looks beautiful.
And but he says that he's it's quite a head turner. He gets a lot of attention.
He said chicks dig it.
Chicks
dig it.
That's important. He's wanted to do a build.
Of every car he's ever had, chicks like that one.
Jeff and I are both a little bit past our sell-by date. It's not really that's not really working for us, Brian. It just gets us in trouble.
That's right.
But I look at Devil's Gal, I think it's some other poor hapless yuck's daughter.
Yeah.
that's not right. What I used to think.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
I got a great video this week. This is a very interesting story. This guy was a carpenter in Southern California.
Okay.
And he wanted to be Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And so he took his video camera with him everywhere he went and made lots of videos. But nice. They just didn't look the same as Hollywood.
Okay.
So he made a lens that would make it look like cinema.
Wow. Ooh.
Guess just what?
For your basic camera.
Before it was over, he doesn't have time to go be a carpenter because he's selling these things hand over fist. He's hiring everybody he knows in his house, finally builds a shop down the street. And because most of the time he was driving 100 miles round trip in L.A. traffic.
And I've done that before to work, yeah.
He sold his car and just wouldn't drive for like 3 years. I know.
It just went in the shell shock, huh?
And he come out and wanted a car, and he decided he wanted an electric car. He has built one from Martha Stewart style, starting with dirt.
Oh, really?
Yeah, if you start with dirt and build the car, you're doing it the hard way.
That's right, yes.
But
you're doing
check
everything.
This out. Jehu.
All right.
Hi, Jack. My name is Jehu Garcia, and I'm from Rancho Cucamonga, California. That's about 30 miles west of Los Angeles. I'd like to show you my EV conversion, my VW bus that I'm converting. But first, let me tell you a little bit about myself and my background and stuff. I'm a carpenter by trade. I worked like 11 years at a dead-end job, you know. I was good at carpentry and stuff, but I just used to hate it. And I plotted my exit and from that job for many, many years until I finally was able to do it. I'm here in L.A., you know, everybody grows up wanting to be in the movie industry, and I was no different. I was really interested in film and filmmaking and all that stuff, so... at that time, the only thing that was available for us was video camera. So I used to always carry my video camera everywhere. So I ended up going into business doing that. I'd figure out how to make this little device and video cameras that would allow you to make your video look more like film. It was essentially like a telescene little machine in front of your video camera, and you would use 35mm lenses. Anyways, I set up, I started working here at my home. It was a home business for the first year. We grew, you know, I was there at the right time with the right product, and we grew. I hired a bunch of people to help me, and eventually, you know, we had like 10 people in our company and stuff. Eventually, we outgrew my home here, and we ended up getting a office and warehouse location, you know, close to by my house. So that's what I'm doing. I own my own business, and that's what I've been doing for the past 2.5 years. I gave away my car when I started doing this business here at home because I was really tired of driving. This job, being the carpenter, it's the darnest thing. It's like in 11 years, I'd never had a job that was close by here, you know, in my same town. I always had to go, you know, 100 miles away or something. Or it wasn't rare that I'd do a 100-mile round trip a day to go to that job. So it was real exhausting, and I was just, my soul was dying because all that time is being wasted here in LA. We have like the worst traffic in the country and stuff. So I was sick and tired of driving. So I gave my car up. I got rid of my work truck, and I, for 4.5 years, I haven't owned a vehicle. So, you know, but now things have changed, and I wanted to get a car, and then I didn't really know what the state of cars was because I was so invested into my business and stuff. And once I started looking more into cars, I was really not interested in anything. You know, I liked like the BMWs and stuff, but I, you know, that's when I saw the Tesla and Model S, and then I was really excited about the technology and about electric vehicles. So that's what got me into this thing. And eventually, my plan is to get into that business because I see a whole revolution coming in the DIY electric vehicle conversion business, because, you know, the OEMs are just not going to do it. So that's a little bit of my background. Let me show you my car now. Now, as you may know, BW started making cars in the early 40s, I think. Hitler himself commissioned Dr. Porsche to make a car for the German people. Now, unfortunately for the German people, the war got in the way, and they didn't get to drive the BW in the early days, as most of the metals and most of the resources were diverted towards a war effort. So, I think by 1943, there was only like 600 Beetles that were made. So, those are really rare, and they're in museums now. But fortunately for us, the English army commissioned someone to start manufacturing the bugs back again after the war in 1949 or 1945 or something. And they did pick up production, and by 1955, they were making their 1 millionth Beetle. They had, in those early days, they had one rule and to keep it simple, and so they only had one body type, and they didn't make a lot of changes throughout those years. It's like all the years, all the parts are mostly interchangeable and stuff. Now, of course, our rules are made to be broken, so they did break their own rule in 1950 because they introduced the BW Transporter. And there's a lot of variants of those. There's like the commercial ones, and then there's the combis, and then there's the passenger ones. And those are really rare. Let's look at, I chose a 57 production. So if we look at the 1957 production, there was a total of just under 92,000 transporters produced that year in 1957. And by 1957, they had moved production to a Hanover plant. They were no longer made in Wolfsburg. Now, out of the 92,000, only 3,500 were the deluxe 23-window Sambas. So that makes the Sambas only 3.8% of the total production of 1957. Now, that's a really rare car. So there's only 3,500 of those cars ever produced. That's 1957. Of course, in those years, Volkswagen was mostly producing cars for the European market. The U.S. really had no, Americans really didn't, they weren't buying into these things. They liked their big cars and stuff. And so much that in 1952, there was only like 600 cars that were sold in the U.S. They started Volkswagen USA, a subsidiary of Volkswagen, in 1955. And at the end of that year, they did sell 30,000 vehicles in the U.S. So in 1957, out of the 92,000 transporters that were manufactured, only 18,366 came into the U.S. market. Now, we don't know how many of those 18,000 were deluxe Sambas. But we do know that the total production, the only 3.8% of total production were Sambas. If we assume that 3.8% of the 18,000 that came in that year were Sambas, that would mean that in the U.S. in 1957, there was only 698 Sambas. So, 700, about 700 of those. So that's a pretty rare car, especially 56 years later. A lot of those have been crushed, a lot of those have been just rusted away and stuff. So, pretty rare 57 Samba. It's so rare that I couldn't find one. And even if I did find one, it was going to be really expensive. I've seen those $160,000, $80,000. It's like ready to be restored kind of thing, just because they're so rare. So I couldn't do that. So what I did is I found a 1957 panel, a commercial vehicle, which were the most widely available vehicle of any year. And I made that bus, the panel, I decided to convert it into my dream 1957 Samba. And by my dream bus, I mean, in those days, Volkswagen was really eager to please. They would pretty much do the car and let you pick any combination of options with your car. Like, for example, if you wanted to paint it your own color and not a Volkswagen color, then they would deliver the car to you in primer, for example. They would put a swivel seat, in your delivery van. So they were really accommodating on the options. So there are some options which are very popular. Some of those are double doors, for example, double cargo doors. And that's modern minivans have that. It's almost like standard. Well, in those days, they only came on one side. My 1957 panel that I bought was a double door. Another option was a walkthrough. And by walkthrough, it means that the front seat is not a bench seat. It's two little bucket seats, and it has a cut in the center of them so that you can walk from the front of your bus to the back area. So that's another option that makes cars valuable. So that's what my Samba is, a 1957 double-door walkthrough Samba. Which is pretty rare. I actually don't know of any factory original Samba made that way, but it could be out there. Like I said, VW, Volkswagen did would let you to choose all those options, and they would build it. So it might be out there. It is completely possible that it is out there and it has been found. but that's what I did. And I like to show you the process. It was a lot of work. I've been working on this thing for 7 months. And, you know, 6.5 of those months, it's really doing all the metal work. And then, you know, in the last 2 weeks, I said, oh, okay, let me throw the electric motor and the batteries and all this other stuff. I'm still not done. It's in the process of finish. But I'd like to show you that.
Show you my 1957 VW Samba bus. So what stands this bus from vehicle from all the other ones is that I've converted into an electric vehicle. And here you can see the batteries. I'm going to have 36 cells for 130 volts, and that's 100 amp batteries. And that should give me, by the time I'm done, I want to have 100 mile range on this. I'm going to have to add more batteries to it. It drives AC induction motor in the back, and the cool thing about this is like completely quiet. It has a lot of torque. It's got more torque than the original motor that came in this car, and it's really fun to drive, and zero emissions, so it's green. And I'm still in the middle of it. It's a process, but I plan to have it done by the next Octa here, and it should be nice and finished and painted. And my plan is to give test drives to everybody that's interested in going electric. They're super simple. It's basically a motor and a controller and a pack of batteries, and that's all you have to put in there. And it's super easy to install. A charger, and you charge your batteries. I'm should be able to charge my batteries in 2 hours, less than 2 hours, and go 100 miles. So that's what allowed me to have this car, basically. It was like, okay, it does everything that I want, and it looks like this. It's like, I think it's a perfect marriage of both techs, you know, like classic car with new technology. So this is actually my first VW vehicle that I ever bought. My brother got into it like about 10 years ago. And I always wanted one, but it had a lot of problems. See, it's like, they go slow, they're noisy, they leak oil all over the place. So I didn't really like them for that. I mean, I like the way they look, but I just, driving it, I thought, no, I want to drive a vehicle that has, like a modern vehicle, you know, that has a modern vehicle experience.
So there it is. I hope you like my project, and I still have a lot of work ahead of me. I need to finish my charger. I ordered an open source 10 kilowatt charger. I want to double my pack to 290 amp hours packs for a total of 180 amp hours, and then I'll see how far that gets me. The goal is to go 100 miles range on this guy, and it's a big boxy car, so I don't know how many amp hours I'm going to need to be able to get 100 mile range on it. I hope to make it to EVCon this year. I'm making arrangements so that I can figure out, see if I can get my electric bus down there. Missouri sounds like a far place to go and take this car, but we'll figure it out. So I hope to see you at EVCon this year and all the attendees. All right.
There you go. That's pretty amazing.
Guys, working on our side of the street.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah. A Samba.
Yeah.
I saw a 21 window on eBay for $109,000 the other day.
Oh, man.
And
God, they used to be worth nothing.
They used to grow used plants to, in
yeah,
them.
Yeah, they used to be worth absolutely nothing.
They used to feed cattle in them.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now you're $109,000. So this guy takes panel truck and makes one out of it.
I can't believe it. I really can't believe it.
Hey, pop a mold on that thing. Make me one out of fiberglass.
Oh, man.
Can you imagine if he did a kit car with a custom chassis? And what would a custom chassis look like for a bus? It's a big square thing with a Volkswagen tranny in the back and the Volkswagen front end in the front from a bus.
Yeah.
And a big fiberglass box.
Yeah, really.
With 21 windows. Now you can use Lexan or polycarbonate. It's completely
legal,
even for the windshield.
Yeah.
So that those curved glasses are no big deal. And he's done everything you would want in a VW van. Doors on both sides,
cargo
the
doors.
Walk-through front seats, the 21 windows.
Yeah.
If he would do that in make a mold for, you know, like the doors and the body and the dash and so forth, and get him a famous shower stall manufacturer to pump these puppies out, make a battery box with a VW transmission in the back and a VW front end on the front, and drop that puppy down on it and call it a kit.
Pretty cool.
Sign me up for the first one.
Yeah.
And that is now probably the best viewer video we've ever received.
I think so.
I can't wait to see your bus at EVCon and to meet you in person. And it's... it's just amazing.
It is. I mean, in the VW world, to do that, to not let alone an electric vehicle, it's a lot of cojones. I like it.
We had one guy sent me an email this month. He wants to come to EVCon and stay and work for us.
Oh, an intern?
Said, come work for free.
Okay.
I told him we don't do free, but come live, kind of, we'll talk. Yeah, we might find something for you to do. We're getting pretty busy around here. Let's see, I had another guy who is a new Volt owner.
Oh.
We're going to have to get more technical. We're starting to get people that like electric cars.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Wanting some help, his Volt would only charge at 3.3 kilowatts, even though it was on a charge point that was supposed to be 7.2. Charge point charger. The EVSE isn't a charger at all. It switches on and off 240 volts AC. It's his charger in the Volt.
Mm-hmm.
That's doing this, and it is in fact a 3.3 kilowatt charger. He can't make it charge any harder. The Volt's got 104 multi-controllers and about 10 million lines of code. I'm gonna bet if I went in and charged that DC, that it couldn't stop me, but the car might not ever, it might fault out where
right,
it
my...
had to be reset by the Pope or something.
That's right.
In order to ever drive again.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
There's nothing you can do. It's your charger, and that's limited. The Volt has a 16 kilowatt battery pack. They never charge it over 80%.
Oh, yeah, okay.
They never let it go below 30% state of charge. So you get 10.4 kilowatts of it.
Right, yeah.
And that's how they're doing the warranty.
Sure, yeah.
Now, this is exactly what I've preached, but taken to an extreme.
Yes, right, exactly.
We don't go that way. We used to tell you 80%, but then we show you how to bottom balance. So when you do go 100%, you can recover. And so it was kind of amazing. But we're... Jeff Southern's coming to EVCON with the thing. It's Jehu Garcia with the VWS, Garcia Samba.
The Samba, the Garcia Samba.
It's E-Samba. Never was a Samba, but it is now. We've got a couple cars coming from High Performance Electric Vehicle Systems.
Yes.
You said John Metrick was going to bring something up.
Yeah, I think John may be bringing his race car.
Ah.
That's what John and I were talking about the other day on the phone.
And so we're actually starting to get kind of a critical level of interest on some very neat builds.
Really cool
builds.
At
the electrical vehicle conversion convention. We'll pour the coffee and set out some sandwiches, and you can come hob and nob in the shop with me and Brian. But the real value of that is to seeing other people's builds and how they did them, and having a day or two to talk to them
right.
And find out why they made those choices and why they do it that way.
Right, right. What would they do different?
And what would they do different if they had a day to shot at
do it again?
and so that's kind of what it's all about. And we have a really good time with it. I had talked to a couple people about doing a California show or East Coast show. The problem is so much of EVCON is an experience that focuses on Jason Horak's car and how to repair it can enjoy the show.
I know, that's exactly.
And we
keep him running.
We have 35 guys in the shop all wrapped around his car, each of them pointing at things and suggesting different fixes.
That's right, this might
and
work.
It's just too much fun. To be believed, so that's kind of a part of the show. Now, how do we transport that?
We'd have to move this entire shop somewhere for a week.
Yeah, I don't see him.
No.
Mark Weisheimer.
Ah, okay.
This guy, he works for AP, was a technician. He used to be a internet service provider.
Oh, okay.
So,
yeah, so we know him from way back machine, yeah.
He's a really, really good electronics engineer. I sent him a couple of these chargers. We're selling a few of these chargers, these DC chargers.
Yes.
I've got a little controller that will control them with CAN bus using the Makina.
Yes, yeah.
And they work
nice product.
Good.
Yeah, they do.
Except Mark was fixing one that wouldn't talk to us. And so he got to playing with it.
Okay. Okay.
So I'm doing CAN bus at the Makina.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Through the TC Charger CAN bus adapter into the charger to tell it to do about two things, what voltage to charge to, and find out what it's saying. Mark tells me it's kind of just TPL serial.
Oh, it's not CAN bus?
Well, that's what the CAN bus adapter is.
Yeah.
So it puts out serial, CAN bus adapter converts to CAN, sends it 6 inches to the Makina, which then reads the CAN and converts it back to serial.
Yeah.
And so I've got some software that's working pretty well with this.
Oh.
And I think we have, I'm hesitant to declare victory for a couple of reasons. One is I have to hand build this thing every time somebody orders one. And it takes me 3 hours to build one. And so
it's like having to go slaughter your own chickens for
like
dinner.
Having somebody order chicken and all I got to do is go find one, kill it, pluck it, and cook it, and I can sell it to them. And so that's a little bit of a problem.
Yeah, that is.
And of course, I'm always scared that something won't be right. But this is kind of a breakthrough in that I think we can wipe out all the canned stuff.
Oh, cool.
The Arduino does. So I've been working on a port to the Dewey, and this is my little shield. I just got the parts. I got four of the boards, and I just got the parts for it. And I'm going to put it together and rewrite the code, hopefully, to do this. It's got a little serial port that's opto-isolated.
Oh, good.
An EEPROM chip, because the Dewey doesn't have one, and I have to save the configuration.
Yes.
And a little 12-volt DC converter. Not so much for isolation, although it does do that, but this has to come up with no computer. And so I want it to be off, but when the charger comes on, it comes up. So I've got a little Ethernet jack here that I'll do the cordage to the charger, and the charger puts out 12 volts, but it'll only do 50 milliamps. It won't power anything. So I'll use that to switch this relay, which turns on the DC to DC converter.
Okay. Yeah.
Which then powers up the Arduino Dewey, which then can talk serial across the port via this Cat5 cable to the charger. And skip the whole CAN bus part.
Okay.
I'm going to go to a Dewey. They're the same price as the Arduino Megas.
Oh.
And both of them are much less than the Makinas.
Right, right.
And then, so we put an EEPROM chip on it.
Okay.
And Colin's already rewritten EEPROM H in Arduino library for the original EEPROM to use this chip through an IC2 or an I2C inter-integrated chip bus.
Okay.
That's from 1980. But it's catching on now.
It's starting to catch on.
I squared C.
Yeah.
Inter-integrated chip bus. And that'll give them 256K ROM. So these are my first prototype, but notice no wires.
I know.
I'll be able to plug components in, solder them down. It's 20 minutes.
Okay, that's a lot better.
Mount it in a box. Should be able to get where I can make these in an hour. And we can dispense with the whole CAN bus thing.
Yeah, that's right.
And so that's my first prototype board.
Nice.
It's kind of cool.
All the components just pop right in and
just nice.
Gotta love it.
And I didn't use any surface mount stuff, so I can kind of see to solder it. Well, kind of.
Don't need a microscope.
Kind of. Yeah. And so we're going to do some other things. Colin and Ed are trying to teach me to use Eagle. It's actually a particularly horrid piece of software.
Uh-oh.
And I've looked at a lot of software in the last 30 years. This is really
pretty bad.
But it's free for little boards.
Oh.
Of course, the version Ed and Colin wanted was $2,400.
But so it wasn't quite the free version.
And it's not any good. It's really bad. By the way, guys, there's some Linux tools out there to do board layout. Gerbers and stuff that work just as well. They're free. In fact, they work better. They're actually better software.
Oh, really?
Than Eagle.
Okay.
And Eagle clearly stole most of that from them. But they didn't advance the token very far.
No, they didn't. Didn't move it.
And the advantage is that Eagle has a lot of component files, libraries.
Okay.
The disadvantage to that is they're mostly done by other people who don't know what they're doing.
Uh-oh.
And they're not right.
Oops.
I found a half a dozen that aren't even close to
really?
Any package that component's available in. So in any event, that's I'm trying to get up to speed on that because it has become the standard for Arduino boards.
Yeah.
Because it's free in that size board. And so that's what I must learn to use to be able to play nicely with the other children. And but that's my first shield, and we'll see how it works. But it could get us out of CAN bus
right.
with the TC charger, and we'll be able to. And we've sold quite a few of them. I got some 168 volts and some 258 volt
yes.
chargers. So far, we sold all 258 volt chargers. So this components business is not.
And we didn't think those were the ones we were going to be selling either. It was
no.
the 250.
Come on, music, bail me out. Let's go home.
I know. Happy day after the 4th of July,
happy
huh?
Happy day after the 4th of July. A lot of neat stuff's happening. We've got a month till EVCON, and we'll see a lot of you there. We're not going to do a show that week.
No show that week. Well, actually, we're going to be doing a show that week. Yes.
It'll be live.
Be live.
Stay with us. We'll see you next week.
All right. See you then.